Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Washington at the Plow, The Founding Farmer and the Question of Slavery by Bruce A. Ragsdale, narrated by Mike Chamberlain. Introduction. The Life of a Husbandman. In late July 1787, during a brief adjournment of the Federal Convention, George Washington traveled with Governor Morris from Philadelphia to a fishing camp near Valley Forge. In the early morning, while Morris went trout fishing, Washington rode to the nearby site of the former encampment of the Continental Army. He found the remaining works at Valley Forge in ruins, and the grounds of the encampment uncultivated. On his ride back to the fishing camp, he observed some farmers at work and stopped to speak with them. Washington learned about their cultivation of buckwheat, a crop he had recently introduced into his experimental system of farming at Mount Vernon. The farmers told him about the various uses they found for the crop, and Washington recorded their advice on sowing the seed. The chance exchange with the unsuspecting farmers was one opportunity among several Washington had to learn about improved agriculture during the summer he presided over the Federal Convention. He attended a meeting of the Philadelphia Society for Promoting Agriculture, which had inducted him as an honorary member soon after its founding in 1785. He visited the farm of his friend Samuel Powell, president of the Agricultural Society, and together they toured the famous nursery of William Bartram. With other convention delegates, Washington observed a farmer's experiments with a soil amendment, which Washington then ordered sent from Philadelphia for an application on the fields at his own farms. Agricultural improvements and the work of nation-building were firmly joined in Washington's mind by the time he attended the convention to draft a new constitution. Soon after his return to Mount Vernon, following resignation of his command of the Continental Army, Washington, in February 1784, described the prospects for the new nation in the language of farming. "We have now a goodly field before us, and I have no wish superior to that of seeing it judiciously cultivated. That every man, especially those who have labored to prepare it, may reap a fruitful harvest." Washington gave life to that metaphor in his ambitious plans for the reorganization of farming at his own estate, and in his determination to prove the practicability of an agricultural system that he believed would be the foundation of commercial prosperity and political stability. Agriculture and commerce were inextricably linked in Washington's vision for the new nation, and he saw in the improvement of agriculture the only source from which we can at present draw any real or permanent advantage. And in my opinion, it must be a great, if not the sole means, of our attaining to that degree of respectability and importance which we ought to hold in the world. As he reminded a Maryland planter in the midst of debates on ratification of the Constitution, "In the present state of America, our welfare and prosperity depend upon the cultivation of our lands and turning the produce of them to the best advantage. A new agricultural order, based on grain farming and stewardship of the land, would promote settled communities and the shared commercial interests that Washington considered the only durable bond of political unions and the foundation of the rising empire he had envisioned even before the War for Independence. The pursuit of agricultural improvement and exchange of scientific knowledge about farming promised to establish peaceful ties between the United States and European nations." Washington equated the promotion of agriculture with the cause of humanity. The story of Washington's life as a farmer fundamentally reshapes the familiar biography of the general and president. A commitment to agricultural improvement defined Washington's pursuit of private opportunities and his expectations for the new nation. The public example of farming at Mount Vernon reflected his ideals of leadership and civic responsibility. Farming framed much about his engagement with the world, near and far, in ways that extended well beyond the marketing of crops. Perhaps most significant, Washington understood slavery primarily through his management of agricultural labor and his recurrent efforts to adapt enslaved labor to new kinds of farming at Mount Vernon. An examination of Washington the farmer also offers a view of his personality and character barely glimpsed through study of his military or political career. Washington considered farming the activity best suited to his disposition, more rewarding than military service or public office, and his agricultural interests revealed a curiosity of mind and boldness of imagination that few discerned in other dimensions of his life. Agriculture was central to Washington's identity and reputation, and in his life as an innovative farmer, Washington defined a new role for an estate owner in an independent nation. Washington grew up in an agricultural society dominated by the production of tobacco that was sold on tightly regulated markets in Great Britain. By 1732, the year of his birth, the great tobacco planters who owned enslaved laborers and rich lands along Virginia's tidal rivers had gained tremendous wealth and controlled access to both economic opportunity and political authority within the colony. Even as many aspiring planters invested in new enterprises or increased their cultivation of grain, they continued to grow the tobacco that remained the most important means of obtaining British credit and manufactured goods. The tobacco trade with Great Britain also offered wealthy planters access to the center of the empire in the personal services of merchants who represented Virginians in legal matters and family business. For all of the many advantages of tobacco cultivation, however, the limits of colonial Virginia's economic success and the costs of its dependence on British trade would become evident to Washington by the time he assumed direction of his own agricultural estate. Washington's family moved when he was 3 years old from the farm where he was born in Westmoreland County to the later site of Mount Vernon, further up the Potomac. When he was six, the family moved again to a farm in King George County across the Rappahannock River from Fredericksburg. With each move, Washington's father, Augustine, worked to increase the value of his investment in the land. Washington's earliest memories of farming were probably from the lands along the Rappahannock, where his father relied on enslaved laborers to cultivate tobacco and grains. Washington's mother, Mary Ball Washington, managed the farm during her husband's two trips to England, and again following Augustine's death in 1743, when the 11-year-old Washington inherited the property. Mary Washington controlled enough enslaved laborers to employ a white overseer, and under their management, one of the enslaved workers served as foreman of field hands as they continued to grow tobacco. For much of Washington's youth, his family faced a precarious economic position, but was always attentive to new prospects. Through his parents' connections with far wealthier planter families, and in the formative time spent with his older brother Lawrence at the expanding Mount Vernon plantation, the young Washington absorbed his first lessons in the successful management of an agricultural estate in Virginia. Washington came of age surrounded by the great planters of the Northern Neck, the area of Virginia lying between the Potomac and Rappahannock rivers. And from those wealthy families, he learned about emerging opportunities for Virginians with sufficient resources to invest. The Northern Neck was the colony's only proprietary grant, held by the time of Washington's birth by the Fairfax family, and the generous terms of the proprietors encouraged individuals to claim vast tracts of land. Even by the standards of land-hungry colonial Virginia, the large planters of the Northern Neck stood out in their zeal for land speculation, especially in the regions west of the Blue Ridge, as far as the Ohio River and its tributaries. Under the patronage of the Fairfax family, Washington received his first job as a surveyor on western lands recently added to the proprietary. And at 16, he saw the potential for the expansion of commercial agriculture into the region. The Northern Neck provided Washington with a distinctive perspective looking east toward Great Britain as well. The Potomac was the most distant from London of the four great rivers of Tidewater Virginia, making commerce between those places more time-consuming and more expensive. Although most of the area's large planters remained involved in the tobacco trade, the tobacco they cultivated was never prized on London markets like that grown along York River to the south, and the planters in Northern Neck were more likely to explore grain cultivation and other investments, like the ironworks in which Washington's father was involved. Military service during the French and Indian War further convinced Washington of the commercial potential of the West, especially at the headwaters of the Potomac River, where he spent much of his time as colonel of the Virginia Regiment. By the time he returned to manage farming at Mount Vernon, Washington had much broader experience than most Virginia planters and was eager to explore opportunities outside the traditional investments of the colonial Virginia gentry. The view from Mount Vernon provided its own broad horizons along the Potomac River that connected the estate to markets throughout the Atlantic and inland toward the Western Territory that Washington was convinced might enrich a new kind of empire, with the Northern Neck at its center. The agricultural possibilities of the estate were never far from Washington's mind, even during the several long absences necessitated by military service and public office. Washington took possession of Mount Vernon in 1754, but spent most of the next 4 years away in military service. He became a full-time farmer in 1759, following his marriage to Martha Dandridge Custis, and over the next decade and a half, he dedicated himself to diversified agriculture and the acquisition of additional land and slaves. While serving as commanding general of the Continental Army from June 1775 to December 1783, he made only one brief visit to Mount Vernon and relied on correspondence with his estate manager in a largely vain effort to keep the farms operating. But during the 5 years following the Revolutionary War, he restructured the entire estate and put in place his most ambitious plan of farming. His duties as President of the United States again removed Washington from the day-to-day supervision of his farms beginning in April 1789. In March 1797, he resumed his close management of agricultural experiments and initiated new enterprises, including a distillery. At the time of his death in December 1799, Washington was in the midst of another reorganization of his farms, with new cycles of crop rotations intended to increase productivity and ensure the fertility of the soil. He remained the innovative farmer throughout his 45 years at Mount Vernon. On his final retirement in 1797, Washington lamented the long absences that had kept him from his preferred life as a farmer. Yet, on each return from public service, he had brought a sharper vision for the reinvention of the traditional Virginia plantation through experiments for the improvement of agriculture and the demonstration of the public benefits of enlightened farming. In the 1760s, he offered his fellow Virginia planters a model of diversified cultivation that would open commercial opportunities outside the confines of the British Empire. Following the Revolutionary War, Washington expected his innovations in farming to be among his most important contributions to the growth of the new nation. In his final and never-realized plans for Mount Vernon, Washington, at the close of his presidency, hoped to prove that a landed estate in Virginia could prosper without reliance on enslaved labor. For Washington, the project of agricultural improvement depended on collaboration among nations, with Great Britain exercising the greatest influence. At each stage of agricultural innovation at Mount Vernon, Washington formed deeper and deeper ties with Great Britain through exchanges of practical knowledge, plant material, and new farming implements. He shared with British agricultural leaders a cultural ideal that entrusted large estate owners with a responsibility to demonstrate improved farming practices. Before the Revolutionary War, as he became a wheat farmer and broke with the colonial dependence on British tobacco merchants, Washington educated himself in the methods of cultivation that had transformed British agriculture during the middle decades of the 18th century. In the years immediately following a destructive war and the disruption of the empire, Washington adopted a comprehensive system of farming based on the latest models of British husbandry. In June 1785, Washington announced that he was desirous of entering upon a complete course of husbandry as practiced in the best farming counties of England. Washington saw no irony in his choice of an agricultural model for the independent nation. British husbandry in the second half of the 18th century was the ideal to which improving landowners in Europe and the United States aspired. And after 1785, Washington introduced the complicated system of crop rotations and livestock management that characterized the most advanced estates in Great Britain. His commitment to British husbandry strengthened as his disappointment with the state of farming in the United States grew. Washington's search for an experienced English farmer to guide his new initiatives attracted the attention of the leading agriculturalists in Great Britain, who offered their support for the farming pursuits of the man most Britons previously knew only as a military commander. The prominent agricultural writer Arthur Young was very glad to find the general as a farmer. Washington soon became the most celebrated farmer of the age. Americans and Europeans alike compared Washington to Cincinnatus at the plow, recalling the Roman general who surrendered authority to return to his farm. This powerful representation of Washington's life as a farmer gave added political significance to his innovations as he figuratively returned to his own plow. And in the years after his resignation from the Continental Army, he sought to reorganize his agricultural estate in ways that would further enhance his reputation and serve as a public example for the new nation. His fame as a farmer attracted the support of European monarchs, British agriculturalists, and American proponents of improvement, who variously presented Washington with newly designed farm implements, rare seeds, new breeds of livestock, and the latest publications on agriculture. A steady stream of visitors came to Mount Vernon to view a startling new agricultural landscape designed by Washington himself. Those visitors also observed the large number of enslaved laborers who worked the land and constructed the massive farm buildings. The agricultural system that was essential to Washington's vision for the new nation and central to his identity and reputation was at his own estate inseparable from the work of the enslaved. Throughout his life as a farmer, Washington depended almost entirely on the labor of the enslaved workers he owned or controlled, and he was at the forefront of efforts in Virginia to adapt slavery to new types of farming. In the transition from tobacco to wheat, he found additional value in and productive work for the increasing number of enslaved people under his control. Long after he first expressed a wish to get quit of Negroes in 1778, Washington applied enslaved laborers to the far more demanding routines of cultivation and to the various trades required of the British system of farming, while he made further efforts to replace hired laborers with enslaved artisans. Washington found no model or precedent for the scale and ambition of his efforts to merge the enlightened and scientific farming of Great Britain with Virginia's system of slavery. When a friend asked for advice about an investment in slaves, Washington, in 1794, confided that with regard to that species of property, "I do not like even to think, much less talk of it." Washington's written comments on the institution of slavery were infrequent and terse, But, in fact, he thought almost continuously about the management of enslaved labor and about the work of enslaved individuals. In the various records of farming at Mount Vernon, Washington left the most detailed documentation of his engagement with slavery and his conflicted attitudes toward the institution. The record of labor management at Mount Vernon, probably the most detailed for any Chesapeake estate in the second half of the 18th century, also describes Washington's frequent interaction with individual laborers. His agricultural ambitions defined the daily work and much about the personal lives of the enslaved at Mount Vernon. And his records of farming and labor offer the most complete, if always imperfect, portrait of enslaved individuals on the estate. Washington's successive schemes for agricultural improvement anticipated widespread efforts of slaveholders to apply enslaved labor to diversified farming as tobacco markets declined following independence, and again when demand for American grain soared in the 1790s. His adaptation of enslaved labor to new crops and crafts occurred during a period of relative stability in the enslaved population, following the closing of slave trade from Africa, and before the rise of an organized internal slave trade forced many enslaved laborers in Virginia to the states to the southwest. During Washington's management of his estate, the enslaved population throughout the Chesapeake grew by natural increase, and the enslaved, including those at Mount Vernon, were able to establish remarkably strong families. As the agricultural economy shifted, enslaved laborers in the Chesapeake became skilled in an increasing variety of tasks. The Revolution profoundly changed slavery in ways that went far beyond the eclipse of Virginia's colonial agricultural economy. During the war, the incursion of British troops offered thousands of enslaved people in Virginia the opportunity to escape bondage, and the many more who remained enslaved at plantations learned of a language of freedom and examples of resistance. By the time Washington returns to Mount Vernon after his resignation from the Continental Army, he had witnessed the rise of an anti-slavery movement that called for the extension of the revolutionary principles of liberty to the enslaved. Even in Virginia, where anti-slavery sentiment was relatively weak, the Assembly prohibited the external slave trade and enacted the first law permitting individual acts of manumission. While he relied more extensively on enslaved labor after the Revolutionary War, Washington implicitly acknowledged the new critique of slavery and the inherent contradiction between a British ideal of farming intended to usher in an era of peaceful prosperity and a system of labor that rested on coercion and a denial of individual freedom. As he presented his farms as a public example, Washington introduced protections for the minimal welfare of the enslaved in an attempt to reconcile his reliance on forced labor with his pursuit of improved agriculture and his aspiration to be recognized as an enlightened and humane estate owner. His efforts to balance those ultimately irresolvable tensions explain much about Washington's conflicted attitude toward slavery during the same years in which he privately offered his first support for the principle of gradual abolition. An exploration of Washington's lifelong experience as a manager of agricultural labor and a focus on his efforts to apply enslaved labor to the course of British husbandry after 1785 offer a new perspective on Washington's eventual decision to free, by the terms of his will, the slaves under his ownership. Among the founders, Washington was the only large slaveholder to provide for freedom of all the slaves he owned, but he offered no explanation of his motives or of his expectations. As several historians have recognized, Washington experienced, or at least acknowledged, no single turning point or revelation leading to his decision to free the slaves. and even after writing his will, he continued to search for new ways to organize enslaved labor more productively. At his death, he was planning to transfer a large number of laborers to cultivate his lands in the West. The path to emancipation was never direct, and it never met the expectations of either the anti-slavery advocates who appealed directly for Washington's support, or of later generations who searched for the moral or humanitarian basis of his decision. Washington's criticisms of the institution of slavery were always complicated by his continuing demands for the labor of the enslaved in the support of his agricultural vision. During the same years in which Washington implemented the full system of British husbandry and designed an ostensibly more rational and humane management of enslaved labor, he faced persistent calls to free the slaves he owned and to endorse a general emancipation as a fulfillment of his role as the champion of American liberty. Following the Revolutionary War, abolitionists in the United States, Great Britain, and France directly appealed to Washington to use his influence and example to advocate for the extension of personal freedom to the enslaved. Whether the entreaties came from close friends like Lafayette or anti-slavery leaders who approached him for the first time, Washington could not escape the implication that his ownership of slaves violated many of the fundamental principles of the American Revolution on which his reputation rested, just as his reliance on coerced labor challenged his identity as an enlightened estate owner, esteemed by British agriculturalists. Among the founders, Washington was the unique object of these anti-slavery appeals, and their coincidence with significant changes in his management of agricultural labor suggests the many ways in which Washington's concern for reputation drove his decisions about the ownership of slaves. Washington found in the British system of farming an additional standard by which to measure the effectiveness of enslaved labor, and his assessment of that labor ultimately reinforced the arguments of the abolitionists who appealed to him. However many provisions Washington made to protect the families and physical well-being of the enslaved, slavery at Mount Vernon remained a harsh labor system from which he never eliminated violent punishment, and the complicated routines of farming introduced after 1785 slowly convinced Washington of the inflexibility and inadequacy of a labor system that rested on coercion and was destructive of trust and collaboration. As early as the fall of 1793, he privately resolved to find some way to free the slaves under his ownership, and by the close of his second presidential term, Washington acknowledged that slavery was antithetical to the kind of agricultural improvement that he believed would be a foundation of commercial prosperity and a demonstration of his own enlightened management. His newfound commitment to emancipation would be evident only in the extraordinary plans to reorganize his farms in ways that would make his estate more nearly like those of the great improving landowners of Great Britain. In this final and most improbable plan of agricultural improvement, Washington imagined a plantation without enslaved laborers. Washington brought a more rational system to the management of his estate, beginning with the original and often unique designs of his farming and financial records. Like many of his British counterparts, he searched for more regular ways to document the seasonal routines of farming from year to year. He relied on his ledgers and account books to monitor networks of exchange in the local community and trade with commercial centers throughout the Atlantic world. He applied the forms of accounting and bookkeeping to the supervision of enslaved laborers and the distribution of their provisions. With his scrupulous accounts of every kind of transaction, Washington created an unmatched record of the conduct of business in Virginia during the last third of the 18th century, as he turned away from a colonial dependence on tobacco exports and produced commodities for sale on markets throughout the Atlantic world. in accounts that measured days worked and others that assigned a monetary value to the labor of the enslaved, Washington devised the kind of records that would enable later slaveholders to adapt the labor force to the demands of highly competitive markets. Many historians have recently emphasized the degree to which slavery, as organized in the United States in the first half of the 19th century, accommodated and even facilitated the transition to a capitalist economy that depended on the rational calculation of costs and productivity and the uniform measurement of labor. Washington recognized the advantages of regularizing his accounts of labor, and he relied on his labor records to monitor and accelerate the pace of work, especially among enslaved artisans and at harvest time. In the anonymous enumeration of field laborers and his weekly work reports, Washington reduced the enslaved individuals to quantifiable units of production, as would the sophisticated accounting records adopted by large-scale cotton planters in the 19th century. Washington relied on the record of days worked to determine the most efficient allocation of enslaved laborers in the increasingly complicated tasks required of the British model of farming. In other ways, the accounts of labor reflected the personal relationships between the enslaved and the enslaver that characterized slavery in the Chesapeake during the late 18th century. The weekly work reports designed by Washington were records of supervision rather than measures of the productivity of enslaved field laborers, and they reflected his definition of personal obligations that he tried to impose on the enslaved. Washington relied on the reports, with their credit and balance ledgers based on the number of laborers, to enforce his notion of the presumed duty of enslaved laborers to work 6 days a week, from sunrise to sunset. In the record of work completed each week on his several farms, Washington measured the days spent on tasks and recorded the reasons for individual absences from labor. But the report seldom included any calculations of either the quantity or value of crops cultivated by the enslaved laborers. Washington rarely compared the costs of provisioning and housing the enslaved laborers with the revenue to be extracted from their work. 2 years after introducing his weekly accounts of labor, Washington acknowledged to Arthur Young that he was not able to give you the price of labor as the land is cultivated here wholly by slaves. Correspondence from Young and other British agriculturalists informed Washington about the more careful calculations of labor costs and productivity on British farms. But the knowledge served primarily to distinguish further the labor systems of Great Britain and Virginia. Washington always sought to balance his pursuit of enlightened management and his idealized vision of a landed estate with the profitability that would make any system of farming viable. But profit alone was seldom the primary consideration in his decisions about crop rotations or the allocation of labor, particularly after 1785. As he reminded several farm managers, "Immediate profit is not so much an object with me," preferring that they focus on the restoration of the land, the planting of new meadows and live hedges, and aesthetic refinement of the grounds of the mansion house. Fields were to be configured as well for appearance as profit. Like some of the wealthiest improving estate owners in Great Britain, Washington deferred short-term profits in his effort to demonstrate a viable and replicable system of farming. And like his associates among the Agricultural Improvement Society in Philadelphia, he understood that the introduction of the British system of husbandry required a significant expenditure of capital. Despite chronic shortages of cash, Washington remained a very wealthy individual with no encumbering debts, and he willingly accepted the costs of the lengthy experiments he deemed essential to innovation. From the construction of a merchant mill to the establishment of a distillery, Washington risked investments in experimental enterprises and mechanical improvements, but almost always with the goal of increasing the value of his agricultural produce or making his estate more self-sufficient in the provisioning of the enslaved laborers. He encouraged the establishment of a mercantile community in the Potomac region, but his own commercial ventures were rare and short-lived. When he promoted corporate schemes for economic improvement, such as opening Virginia's rivers to navigation, it was in support of expanding commercial agriculture into the West, which he expected to advance his private interests as well as the political order of the region. Washington's most important investments beyond Mount Vernon were in the purchase and settlement of Western lands, from which he hoped to derive income based on leases to a large number of tenants who would support an even more ambitious and British-inspired model of landed wealth. For all of his innovations and experiments, Washington approached opportunity as an 18th-century landed gentleman rather than a 19th-century entrepreneur. For as long as Washington managed farming at Mount Vernon, he was dedicated to experiment and to the exchange of agricultural knowledge with improving landowners throughout much of the Atlantic world. And in his agricultural innovations, Washington emerged most clearly as a figure of the Enlightenment. Through his extensive reading in agricultural treatises and his adoption of new methods of cultivation, Washington entered a community of agricultural improvement in Great Britain and established himself at the forefront of new farming in the United States. He participated in a steadily expanding network for the exchange of plant materials and livestock and benefited from the findings of naturalists spread throughout the British Empire. Agriculture remained the most powerful component of a broader cultural authority that Washington ascribed to Great Britain, and his deference to British custom shaped his perspective on the new nation's relations with Great Britain long after the sovereignty of the United States was secured. Washington discovered in the British definition of agricultural improvement, with its emphasis on private property and the decisive influence of knowledgeable gentry farmers, a new and professedly public-spirited role for the owner of a large landed estate in the United States. Before and after the Revolutionary War, Washington expected wealthy landowners like himself to accept the financial risks required for experiment and innovation, and he believed that only those with sufficient resources and access to books and learned correspondence would be able to offer smaller farmers a model for the reversal of ruinous methods of cultivation. He presented himself as a different kind of Virginia planter, committed to innovation and conversant in the principles of British husbandry, with its promise of steady gains in productivity and increased land values. Like the advocates of improvement in Great Britain, Washington offered his agricultural knowledge and innovation as a kind of civic responsibility. Throughout his life, he adhered to this explicitly elitist model of agricultural improvement, and his assertion of agricultural influence reinforced his deeply held preference for leading through example rather than persuasion or public advocacy. Washington's example of improvement and his emphasis on the civic benefits of his innovations found a striking parallel in the contemporaneous agricultural projects of George III. The king's early interest in farming provoked biting satire of Farmer George, but George III initiated public-spirited efforts, including an experimental course of husbandry very similar to that pursued by Washington. Soon after he gained control of Windsor Great Park, with its nearly 4,500 acres of pleasure gardens, hunting grounds, and isolated farms, the king converted much of the land to experimental farms, and he hired an innovative firm of estate managers to introduce the most recent advances in crop rotations, livestock management, and the design of farm buildings. He encouraged the managers to focus on the larger social goals of the agricultural experiments, such as creating useful labor for the industrious poor, and trying experiments in agriculture to excite imitation where success might encourage it. George III actively directed many of the improvements and drew on his own considerable knowledge, much of it gained from the same agricultural treatises Washington read. Arthur Young was a favorite of both, and they concluded from their reading of Young that farming was the appropriate responsibility of a leader who wished to promote the economic prosperity and social order of a nation. The experimental character of Washington's agricultural improvements and his commitment to a commercially productive use of natural resources drew him to a particular ideal of stewardship of the land articulated by British agricultural writers and naturalists. Perhaps more than any of his contemporaries in the United States, Washington placed the restoration and maintenance of soil fertility at the center of his system of farming. He saw in the gullied and depleted landscape of so many Virginia farms the destructive effects of the long dependence on tobacco and corn, and a labor system that encouraged the quick exhaustion of the soil. He had no interest in the practical experience of colonial farmers who found crude but effective ways to cultivate fertile lands, nor did he acknowledge the examples of Indian farming he frequently encountered in his travels west. He relied rather on British models of soil management and the experiments of farmers in the United States who read the same British treatises and adhered to the same methods described in them. For British agriculturalists, like Arthur Young, the study of soil was the greatest responsibility of landowners, and the concept of agricultural improvement adopted by Washington presumed a civic, even moral, obligation of estate owners to make the best use of land over time. Improvement, in this sense, depended on control of the land by learned and cosmopolitan estate owners who understood a science of agriculture and directed farming toward the lasting production of commercial crops. In his expansive authority over his estate of nearly 8,000 acres and the several hundred enslaved persons who labored there during his lifetime, Washington displayed his sense of command and his insistence on control and order. He was a demanding and rarely satisfied supervisor of both enslaved and free labor, and he was seldom comfortable delegating the management of farming or business affairs. Some thought they could identify in Washington's management of his estate the imperious habits of a military commander, with his references to labor gangs as forces and workers marching and countermarching. But the military analogies failed to recognize the degree to which Washington, as a farmer, attempted to exercise a mastery checked only by his own sense of responsibilities. He frequently bypassed the hierarchy of managers and overseers to communicate directly with individual enslaved laborers and to issue his own orders for the work of field laborers. No detail was too small for his attention, and no misstep of others safe from his admonishment. Washington's lifelong engagement in farming offers a window on a personal self that remained a mystery for the many who observed him in public life, and for subsequent generations that knew only the revered Stoic leader. As master of Mount Vernon, more than in any other aspect of his life, Washington asserted his personal will and resolve. Richard Peters, who knew him as a general, as a president, and perhaps most closely as a farmer, offered a retrospective character sketch that found Washington's victory over his natural temperament as one of the greatest he had obtained. In Washington's relationship with the overseers on his farms, with the merchants who marketed his produce, and with the enslaved across the estate, that victory was incomplete. The enslaved frequently met with Washington's anger and his disparagement of their work. In business transactions and in the regulation of overseers, Washington exhibited the indignation and petulant sarcasm that he had learned to moderate in public life in the years following service in the French and Indian War. But Peters also identified in Washington's private life a cheerfulness, pleasantry, and disengaged conversation unfamiliar to those who mistook Washington's public circumspection for aloofness or indifference. Peters knew that, in addition to the comforts of domestic life, Washington discovered in the routines of farming at Mount Vernon a personal gratification seen nowhere else in his life. After several years of closely supervising every aspect of farming at Mount Vernon, Washington found, on reflection, the life of a husbandman, of all others, is the most delectable. It is honorable, it is amusing, and with judicious management, it is profitable. To see plants rise from the earth and flourish by the superior skill and bounty of the laborers fills a contemplative mind with ideas which are more easy to be conceived than expressed. Washington, in the sweeping reorganization of farming on his estate, attempted to realize the ideal he had absorbed from British agricultural literature, with its celebration of the active, engaged landowner on whom improvement depended. He transformed the working landscape of the farms and imposed a new regimen on the enslaved field laborers, expecting to establish a rural order born of a knowledge gained from his extensive reading and his communications with improving farmers in Great Britain and the United States. That ideal of a balanced order rooted in nature and improved by human endeavor would instead remain in conflict with the system of enslaved labor on which Washington established agriculture at Mount Vernon. The examination of what remains the least familiar dimension of Washington's life deepens and complicates understanding of his public leadership and his self-identity. Farming was never just a private enterprise, and even less a gentlemanly pastime. It was, for Washington, a measure of his abilities and virtue, similar to the tests of military command and public service, and he invested his agricultural improvements with a civic purpose that he believed would constitute an important part of his legacy. His awareness of the public audience for his agricultural innovations and the implications for his reputation established a critical context for his focus on the national benefits of improvement, and ultimately for his decision to free the slaves on whom he had relied to carry out his agricultural vision. As a farmer, Washington responded to the pivotal opportunities that he believed would define a post-colonial economy and ensure the stature of the United States among the nations of the Atlantic world. In his determination to secure those opportunities through the example of farming at his estate, and to join his efforts with those of a self-defined community of enlightened landowners, Washington would inescapably confront the fundamental contradictions of slavery and freedom in the founding era. 1. The Experiments of a Virginia Planter. In March 1760, less than a year after Washington returned to Mount Vernon following his marriage to Martha Dandridge Custis, he and Peter, an enslaved blacksmith, worked together to make a plow designed in part by Washington. After that effort failed, Washington returned to the smith shop a week later to spend the greatest part of the day in making a new plow of my own invention. The following day, the new plow was set to work in the lower pasture and answered very well. Since February, Washington had been supervising a new regimen of plowing across the estate at the start of the first season of his full-time management of the farms at Mount Vernon. Over several weeks in late winter and early spring, he relied on an enslaved man he referred to as Mulatto Jack, and another he distinguished as Cook Jack, to plow new ground for growing clover, lucerne, and rye. As he directed the sowing of seeds he had ordered from London, Washington turned to Jethro Tull's horse-hoeing husbandry for instruction on the cultivation of lucerne and sainfoin, another fodder crop. He carefully recorded the placement of seeds in experimental beds to try their goodness and to measure the several virtues of compost mixtures he prepared. Washington refitted the mechanisms on his plows, both those crafted by the blacksmiths at Mount Vernon and those shipped from England, and he employed a succession of horses to determine which type was best suited to field work. Washington's new interest in fodder crops and plowing marked the initial step in his application of the methods of British husbandry that would guide his management of Mount Vernon as he made farming his principal occupation over the next decade and a half. By the spring of 1760, Washington aspired to be an enlightened landowner, committed to innovation and experiment, drawing on the knowledge found in British agricultural treatises and shared by a select group of Virginia planters. Following the British methods of agricultural improvement, Washington applied his learning to the practical tasks of farming, with daily visits to his fields where he became familiar with the soil and the growth of crops. His close observation of unfamiliar crops and of the use of new implements allowed him to measure precisely the results of his new ventures and to impose greater regularity on the seasonal patterns of farming. Washington imposed the same demands for order and regularity on the enslaved laborers, who came under his closer observation and the stricter supervision of white overseers. Washington also recognized that agricultural change at Mount Vernon depended on the education of the enslaved in new skills. Mulatto Jack was almost certainly a novice at plowing, since he had, until 1759, been enslaved on the Custis estates, where no plows were used. But he and Cook Jack made themselves indispensable to Washington as the only slaves capable of managing a plow during this first season of new farming. When Washington ordered these men to other tasks, plowing came to a stop. As Washington diversified agriculture over the next decade, he purchased slaves who would bring valuable skills to Mount Vernon, and he directed enslaved workers on the estate to carry out more difficult tasks that previously required the costly hire of free laborers. Washington's design of agricultural improvement would continue to drive his management of enslaved labor and give greater value to his investment in slaves, even as he moved away from the staple agriculture that had given rise to the Chesapeake system of slavery. Washington first leased Mount Vernon in 1754 from the estate of his late brother Lawrence, when, following the recent death of Lawrence's only child, he could anticipate that he would eventually inherit Mount Vernon and that it would likely be his primary source of income. Over the next 4 years during his service in the French and Indian War, he only intermittently managed farming at Mount Vernon, even admitting to an English tobacco merchant in 1757, "I am so little acquainted with the business relative to my private affairs that I can scarce give you any information concerning it." Until his resignation from the Virginia Regiment in December 1758, Washington relied on managers and overseers to pursue a familiar pattern of plantation management, with only limited efforts toward diversification. Tobacco was well established as the most important cash crop at Mount Vernon, as well as at Washington's Bullskin Plantation to the west in Frederick County. Washington grew varieties of the premium sweet-scented tobacco at both estates, and during the 1750s, he usually sold his combined crop of tobacco through consignment to merchants in England. Alexandria merchant John Carlyle, who as commissary to the Virginia Regiment was in frequent contact with Washington, often managed the shipment of the tobacco, and from 1755 to 1758, Washington's brother John Augustine managed much of the farming and other estate business at Mount Vernon. On the recommendations of Carlyle and George William Fairfax, Washington opened correspondences with several English merchants, including Richard Washington of London. Washington expected his namesake, although no relation, to become his principal agent in London for both the sale of tobacco and the purchase of British goods to furnish Mount Vernon. In return for the consignment of tobacco, these merchants sent Washington basic farming implements such as hoes and scythes, and clothing for enslaved laborers. Richard Washington also sent tools used in the redesign of the house at Mount Vernon, and the goods to furnish what its owner, even from his remote military posts, intended to make a genteel seat characteristic of a Virginia tobacco planter. On his infrequent visits to Mount Vernon during the French and Indian War, and in correspondence with Carlyle and John Augustine, Washington encouraged new farming endeavors to supplement the uncertain returns from tobacco. Both of his estates produced wheat that was sold locally, and on at least one occasion shipped to a Norfolk merchant involved in the West Indies trade. Washington continued to acquire cattle and sheep for Mount Vernon, and he ordered the creation of new fields and meadows for the support of livestock and the cultivation of new crops. The grist mill at Mount Vernon, despite an unreliable flow of water, attracted the business of area farmers who brought their wheat and corn to be ground. The purchase and hire of additional enslaved laborers enabled Washington to take the first steps toward increased production of crops and greater self-sufficiency of labor on his plantations. Between October 1754 and January 1758, he or his agents purchased at least 14 slaves and rented the labor of 4 more. 3 of the purchased slaves were carpenters who worked on the construction of tobacco houses and slave quarters and the expansion of Washington's own house. Washington ordered Cleo, whom he purchased for £50 in 1755, to make clothes for the enslaved in what he considered her leisure hours, presumably after her work in the fields. In January 1756, John Carlyle, accompanied by Washington's brother, took the liberty of purchasing for Washington 3 slaves whom they deemed so good a bargain. Carlyle also purchased for Washington an enslaved woman and child sold by Governor Dinwiddie. The additional slaves, however, were insufficient to meet Washington's demand for labor at wheat harvest, and at Mount Vernon and Bullskin, overseers paid free laborers to thresh wheat. The overseers of both estates sought to convince a skeptical Washington that they had satisfied his expectations of detailed attention to farming and constant work from enslaved laborers. Humphrey Knight at Mount Vernon pleaded, "I hope you will not be doubtful of my diligence in your business. I'll lose my life before anything shall go amiss." Christopher Hardwick, overseer at Bullskin, insisted that he never failed to apprise Washington of important business. Knight, with a casual reference to his violent oversight of labor, reported that he closely monitored the carpenters and has whipped them when I could see a fault. He promised to work all of the enslaved laborers to Washington's advantage. The overseers repeated assurances in response to Washington's complaints about their management and infrequent written reports were an early indication of the friction that would mark Washington's relationship with overseers throughout his life. Whatever frustration Washington may have felt about the management of his estates, he received during the growing season of 1758 encouraging reports about the potential for farming at Mount Vernon. George William Fairfax assured Washington that his plantations had produced the finest crops of tobacco and corn that he had seen that year. John Carlyle affirmed that Washington's crops were the best of their kind in the county, and Humphrey Knight, who managed the crop, added, "I don't see a better crop of tobacco anywhere." As he prepared to set aside his military ambitions, Washington could anticipate that the management of his agricultural estate might secure his private fortune and his public reputation. In the spring of 1759, Washington, for the first time, had the opportunity to direct a sustained course of farming at Mount Vernon, and through his marriage to Martha Custis earlier that year, he gained the financial resources and the control of additional enslaved laborers that would enable him to expand the scale of production beyond anything he previously envisioned. The Mount Vernon estate, to which Washington escorted Martha and her 2 children in April 1759, extended to nearly 2,800 acres, and Washington owned as many as 20 slaves who lived and worked at Mount Vernon. The details of the land were sufficiently unfamiliar to Washington that in October 1759, he decided to mark the exact boundaries of the estate. Relying on his surveying skills, Washington spent 2 days recording the pole distances along the perimeter of an estate that he described largely in terms of trees. The markers of a crooked elm and a stooping locust were characteristic of Virginia deeds, but the survey notes also reflect an instinctive eye for the natural landscape and the agricultural potential of the soil. Washington further noted tenant properties and bogs that would soon be eliminated in his determination to consolidate and coordinate the use of arable land. Because Martha's first husband, Daniel Park Custis, had died without a will, she was entitled under Virginia law to 1/3 of his personal property and to life rights to 1/3 of the Custis estate's land and slaves. These dower rights gave Washington access to the Custis cash reserves and the estate's favorable balance with London merchants, enabling Washington to purchase slaves in unprecedented numbers and to acquire surrounding land. Over the next 16 years, he would more than double the acreage at Mount Vernon and buy more than 60 slaves. His first land purchase was the largest, more than 1,800 acres across Little Hunting Creek, bought from William Clifton. This problematic transaction eventually brought Washington control of what would form the basis of River Plantation, the largest at Mount Vernon. Before and after coming into ownership of Mount Vernon following the death of Lawrence's widow, Anne Lee, in March 1761, Washington bought several other parcels that he incorporated into existing plantations or added to the Clifton property. By the summer of 1764, the Mount Vernon estate encompassed nearly 5,500 acres. Washington quickly merged his lands at Mount Vernon so that he could bring farming across the estate under his own coordinated management. He chose not to renew the leases of some of the tenants on the estate, and he bought out others. A few tenants continued to rent land on the periphery of the estate and to pay their annual rent in tobacco. Washington followed the same strategy with his newly purchased land on Clifton's Neck. A survey of the Clifton property, which Washington occupied and annotated soon after purchasing the land in 1760, revealed a jumble of leaseholds. Washington determined to consolidate as much of the land as possible to establish new plantations. After removing or relocating several of the tenants, Washington reported in August 1764 that he had long been pestered with a tenant that lives in the very heart of the plantations which I have settled in Clifton's Neck. He had already come to the man with various propositions, but wanting him away now more than ever, Washington attacked him again and persuaded him to relocate to Frederick County, where he could lease land owned by Washington's brother Charles. In a 1766 survey of the Clifton land, which he now referred to as his farm on Little Hunting Creek and the Potomac River, Washington documented the clear division of the plantation into three large fields, which could accommodate the three-year rotation of crops he instituted that year. Over the spring and summer of 1759, Washington purchased 15 slaves, nearly as many as all his previous purchases combined. At the appraisal of the Custis estate that same year, Martha received the property rights to 84 slaves. The Washingtons brought at least a dozen of these individuals to Mount Vernon, where they worked and lived alongside the slaves Washington owned, although their legal status remained distinct. Washington controlled the dower slaves during his lifetime, but he could not sell any of them without compensating the Custis estate. If a dower slave married a slave owned by Washington, as often happened, the legal status of their children, like the condition of enslavement itself, was determined by the status of the mother. Washington drew on cash from the Custis estate for the several slave purchases made in Williamsburg during the spring session of the House of Burgesses in 1759. In August of that year, he drew £99 sterling from the Custis account with a Hanbury merchant firm in London to pay slave traders who had recently offered for sale in Maryland what they called choice healthy Gold Coast slaves. The Africans purchased by Washington worked as field laborers at the outlying plantations at Mount Vernon. Hannah and her child, bought from a neighbor of the Custis estate in June 1759, may have been known to Martha and the slaves from the Custis estate. Several years later, Washington listed her as the wife of Morris, one of the dower slaves brought to Mount Vernon in 1759. During the next 4 years, Washington continued to purchase slaves, some as individuals and some in groups as large as seven. Most of the individuals he purchased had already been enslaved in Virginia or Maryland, and several were sold as part of the settlement of estates. Washington also participated in sales that exposed the vast scale and brutality of the trade from Africa to the Chesapeake. The August 1759 sale in Maryland had offered 350 enslaved Africans transported on a single ship. 2 years later, Washington went to Lower Marlborough, Maryland, to purchase sundry slaves from the ship Africa, which advertised a cargo of choice, healthy, fine slaves, consisting of men, women, boys, and girls. Later, in 1761, Washington purchased from Thompson Mason several slaves recently transported from either Africa or the Caribbean. The final division of slaves from Lawrence Washington's estate in 1762 brought his brother control of another five adults and two children. The recently acquired slaves, particularly those who had worked on Virginia plantations, brought a greater diversity of skills to Mount Vernon. Washington increased the number of carpenters, whose work was essential to the introduction of new crops and the construction of shelters for livestock. The carpenters made plow stocks, yokes for oxen, and tumbrels for the oxen to pull. Washington sent more than half the new slaves, and all but one of the enslaved women, to work in the fields. The new purchases, combined with the natural increase of resident slaves, brought the number of enslaved adults at Mount Vernon to 68 by July 1765. In his purchase of slaves and land, Washington followed a well-established path of aspiring gentry planters in 18th-century Virginia, and he somewhat more cautiously sought to improve his advantages in the tobacco trade, the other traditional foundation of planter wealth. The Custis connection offered Washington an entree to three prestigious British merchant firms that had managed the sale of the premium tobacco leaf grown on the Custis lands along York River. In May 1759, Washington introduced himself to Robert Carey and Company, the firm that usually received the greatest share of the Custis tobacco. More recently, Martha Custis had managed the estate's business with the Carey firm following the death of her first husband in 1757. Washington informed the Carey partners that by marriage he was entitled to one-third of the Custis estate, and he assured the merchants that he would continue and perhaps increase the consignment of tobacco in proportion as I find myself and the estate benefited thereby. Washington would soon add the tobacco cultivated at Mount Vernon and Bullskin to the Carey consignments. A merchant firm of the scale and reputation of Carey and Company offered Washington incentives to continue organizing his crop production around the London tobacco market. The Carey firm managed the valuable Custis stock in the Bank of England. It had long-standing relationships with buyers of premium tobacco, and it worked with the leading London shops and manufacturers that catered to the Virginia trade. Even as Washington recognized and pursued the potential benefits of trading with leading merchants like Carey and Company, he entered these commercial relationships with a skepticism and mistrust that would grow over the next few years. By the close of his service in the Virginia Regiment, Washington had come to doubt that British officers and administrators accepted colonial Americans as equal partners in the defense and promotion of imperial interests. He confronted each of the Custis merchants with a defensive tone that echoed this perceived lack of British respect for colonials. Early in his correspondence with the Carey firm, Washington criticized the merchants for their premature sale of Custis tobacco, when a short delay would have been to his advantage. When he asked the same merchant for an estimation of prices he could expect for his Potomac tobacco, He advised them to be well informed in their answer, or I might possibly think myself deceived and be disgusted accordingly. Washington warned James Gildart, a Liverpool tobacco merchant, to be careful in his selection of goods for the estate, because Virginians sometimes suffer vile impositions from the dishonesty of the tradesmen. After returning to Mount Vernon from his disappointments in the Virginia regiment, Washington found in each successive consignment of tobacco evidence that the trade in the staple crop was one more supposed benefit of the British Empire that, in fact, placed Virginia planters at a perpetual disadvantage. The Custis estate had, in many ways, been a model of the reciprocal benefits of empire for British merchant and Virginia planter in the first half of the 18th century, and in his administration of the affairs of Daniel Park Custis, Washington learned about the organization of one of the colony's wealthiest estates and largest producers of tobacco. In the year and a half between her husband's death and her marriage to Washington, Martha managed much of the Custis business and was appointed by a county court as administrator of the estate. At its April 1759 session, the Virginia General Court recognized Washington's legal authority to administer his wife's share of the estate and his responsibility for managing the 2/3 of the estate that would be divided between Martha's 2 surviving children. Between April and October 1759, Washington, working closely with the attorney John Mercer and consulting Martha, drafted accounts of the Custis assets and debts for the commissioners appointed to oversee the distribution of the estate among the 3 heirs. When he prepared to meet with Mercer in August 1759, he anticipated that it would be necessary that Mrs. Washington should accompany me in order to clear up any doubtful matters. The various accounts, most of which Washington laboriously copied for his own records, detailed the vast holdings of the Custis estate and the organization of its working plantations. The estate extended to nearly 18,000 acres spread over 6 counties, and at the time of the appraisal controlled 283 slaves, valued at £8,958. Overseers directed work at individual plantations, and the estate was so large that Custis had appointed Joseph Valentine as a steward, in the terminology of English estates, to manage much of the business of the collective plantations. Washington made copies of the inventories of property in the 6 counties, familiarizing himself with the detailed lists of each slave by name and appraised value, the livestock numbering in the hundreds, and scores of farming implements. Despite its scale of operation and the cultivation of corn, wheat, and oats, the Custis estate adhered to an older model of tobacco production, with no evidence of the recent improvements in British agriculture that already attracted Washington's interest at Mount Vernon. Only on the Eastern Shore plantations were there 4 old plows, while the Tidewater plantations were firmly fixed in cultivation with the hoe. Nor were there implements of domestic manufactures. The extensive collection of Custis books Washington brought to Mount Vernon included older works on gardening and botany, but none of the British treatises of practical farming that he ordered for himself. In addition to the slaves, who were together valued at nearly £3,000, Martha's dower, which came under Washington's control and management, included Claiborne's plantation, with 2,880 acres in King William County, the bridge and ship landing quarters, with a combined 1,000 acres in York County, a nearby mill, a house in Williamsburg, and several lots in Jamestown. The Custis estate was remarkable in Virginia for the size of its capital assets, and Martha, in her management of the estate, carried on her late husband's practice of making large loans to prominent Virginia families. The recovery of debts owed to both her and the Custis children would involve Washington in the business of several of those families and provide him with a unique perspective on the risks of mismanagement and reckless spending by the colony's largest landholders. At Mount Vernon, Washington divided the arable lands into working quarters called plantations, similar to the Custis estate and other large tobacco-growing estates. Before 1759, the cultivated areas at Mount Vernon consisted of the Home Plantation surrounding Washington's residence and Muddy Hole Plantation to the north, where tobacco was grown. Beginning in 1759, Washington organized Dogue Run Plantation on the creek of the same name, and partially formed out of lands purchased in 1757. Williams's plantation, renamed Creek Plantation in 1761, comprised land formerly leased by tenants. Land purchased from William Clifton was consolidated as River Plantation, established by 1761. At the four outlying plantations, which together produced estates tobacco, Washington installed overseers, who, as of 1761, each managed the work of between 4 and 10 enslaved field laborers. The Home Plantation grew wheat, hay, and other crops to support livestock, and was also the site of the largest orchards on the estate. By June 1761, 9 enslaved field laborers worked at the Home Plantation. Also living and working in close proximity at the home house were 7 enslaved carpenters, 2 enslaved blacksmiths, and 10 enslaved servants in the mansion. This organization of the estate and division of laborers defined much about the community and family connections for the enslaved, although marriages across plantations were common. Washington frequently coordinated the management of the Mount Vernon plantations with that of his Bullskin plantation in Frederick County. In addition to combining the tobacco crops for marketing, he transferred farming implements and livestock between the estates, and he occasionally moved enslaved workers from one property to the other. Washington was less directly involved in the supervision of the plantation in King William County and the other Custis properties, where Joseph Valentine continued as manager. But he regularly visited these properties on his way to or from sessions of the House of Burgesses. Washington also directed the shipment to Robert Carey and Company of tobacco from the Custis properties under his direct control and those he managed as guardian for Martha's son, John Park Custis. Washington understood the operation of the Custis plantations well enough to recruit an overseer from one of the York River quarters to work at Mount Vernon's River Plantation, and to transfer enslaved field workers who had not been among the initial removal of dower slaves to Mount Vernon. In important ways, Washington's ambitions for Mount Vernon diverged from the model of the Custis estate and the traditional focus on tobacco cultivation.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.